To the Philippine Benchmark Index now, the PSEI bucking the regional downswing. It closed higher at 66.87 after gaining 0.3%. Value turnover was at 4.2 billion pesos. Alfred Garcia of AP Securities Incorporated is now with us for Market Chat. Hi, Alfred. Welcome to the Business Roadshow.
Hi, Stanley. Good to see you again.
Good to see you again. Now, everyone's excited about possible interest rate easing by the Federal Reserve. Of course, the timeline is September. There are talks it's going to be August and even July, would you believe? Now, are you feeling that possibility now based on the fairly numerous speeches by Fed Chair Jerome Powell hinting of much sooner rate cuts?
Actually, Mr. Powell has markedly toned down the hawkish rhetoric in recent speeches, even going as far as saying that the Fed doesn't need to wait for inflation to hit 2% before cutting, because then it will be too late. So now with the U.S. inflation at 3% as of June, and with indicators pointing to further cooling in inflation, the Fed chairman seems to be laying the groundwork for an imminent cut. So while it's very unlikely that the Fed will cut rates at the July 31 meeting, at the moment the US Fed funds futures is pricing in a near certain rate cut on September 18, and we are inclined to believe that that would be true.
And in the event, of course, that there will be an earlier rate cut by the Federal Reserve, and the BSP has been hinting as well of rate cuts by September, do you think policy easing can also come early for the Philippines, or at least soon after the U.S. does? And perhaps more importantly, is it prudent to do so?
Hopefully so. Actually, the next scheduled monetary board meeting is on August 15, followed by one on October 14. So the Fed meeting falls somewhere between those two dates. I think it's fine even if the BSP decides to cut ahead of the Fed in August, as long as it's extremely certain that the Fed will cut in September. It's just 1 month, and as long as the Fed is sure to cut in September, at least we know that the differential will return to normal after a month. And so although, of course, it would be best if they cut after the Fed to maintain that 1% differential between the U.S. and Philippine benchmark rates and avoid weakening the peso further.
Right. Okay. When you talk about bets now, it's really 25 basis points, at least, is the most prudent amount. We know that cutting policy rates by that little may not be enough to, you know, drive significant optimism in the markets. What do you imagine a 25 bips cut could do immediately to our markets?
You know, technically speaking, 25 bips is not much, and definitely the effect is not immediate. It takes time for changes in the interest rate to work its way through the system, and it's a small amount to begin with, so it probably won't move the needle by much, at least in the short term. However, the first rate cut is mostly symbolic. So even if it's just 25 bips, the market will likely react strongly as it signals that the beginning of an easing cycle. So historically, the market typically goes up by around 10 to 15% after an easing cycle begins.
Okay, so that's about 10 to 15% in your view. Now, what scenarios, Alfred, are you seeing for full-year corporate earnings for 2024, given still the lag effects of the cuts? I mean, a lot of these changes in interest rates could be felt really next year.
Well, our base case scenario for our index forecast is that earnings will grow by around 8.8%, exactly because of the delay in rate cuts and the lag in the effects. So basically, you won't feel it until next year. Yeah. Admittedly, this is already extremely conservative, as most analysts are forecasting around 10 to 13% earnings growth. So medyo, we're kind of playing safe there. Yeah. You can say that this is already the worst case scenario, with the best case scenario at 13% plus growth.
Of course, we're looking at it from both the perspective of corporate earnings and even growth projections for the Philippines, in which case, you know, recently AMRO has revised its forecasts from 6.3, putting it down to 6.1% for 2024 for the Philippine GDP. Now, what catalysts, perhaps, do you see that could change this course?
Well, given that we're more than halfway through the year, and the likely scenario is that capital formation and consumer spending continue to slow down in Q2, I think it's a reasonable move to start making downward revisions to economic growth forecasts. However, if we see a significant pickup in government spending, maybe, especially on infrastructure, it might somehow give a boost to the economy. And recently, there's data that came out that remittances somehow grew year on year, and especially in peso terms. So that might have fueled a bit, that might have given a bit of a boost to consumer spending.
All right, let's talk about today's trading now, Alfred. Let's bring in the chart today. We're looking at, of course, a steep climb to the 6,700 level, with investors and traders barely catching their breath in the last 3 days. Today, there's been some profit taking, but we still ended in the green, making that chart a lot steeper than yesterday, putting the index now at a very, you know, uneasy level. Where do you see that trend going from here?
Well, exactly 10 years ago, the index was at 6,867. So we ended slightly below that. Basically, it tells you that our market is in a long-term sideways trend.
Yeah.
And this market movement is very typical of a sideways market where investors take profits at the first chance they get because they have been burned too many times. So okay. Q2 earnings is just around the corner and the market is continually pricing in changes to expectations for rate cuts. So we'll likely continue to see volatility in the market, but mostly moving within that 6.3 to 6.7 range.
All right. Interestingly, a lot of investors had been burned, as you mentioned, but there are also those that are eager beavers. What are you telling them? Those who may just be too optimistic about the upcoming rate cuts catapulting this market to these heights. Now, how do you balance the excitement with reality?
Why do we need to balance the excitement? Isn't excitement exactly what we need? Kidding aside, I understand the excitement, and surely rate cuts will definitely be a positive catalyst for the market. But I would like to remind investors to still be selective about stocks that they go into, because we're not quite at that the rising tide floats all boats scenario just yet. So make sure to pick fundamentally sound companies with reasonable debt levels, good prospects for earnings growth, and of course, good corporate governance.
All right, and if you look at the counters, there are also exciting developments, at least when you talk about stock picking for better times. It is now time, or in fact, is it now time to buy the sectors that have been down in the past 12 months? And if so, which ones?
Yes, actually, we have been seeing a rotation into names that have been battered in recent months. Notably, these are mostly from the property and consumer sectors, and to a certain extent, telco sector as well. These were our top picks earlier in the year, before the easing cycle was delayed. And I believe that they have regained their appeal now that it seems that rate cuts are already on the horizon finally.
All right. On that note, Mr. Alfred Garcia, Research Head of AP Securities Incorporated, thank you so much again for joining us for this conversation.
Thank you very much for having me.